Hey friends, did you know that with Azure Database for MySQL Flexible Server, you can host your MySQL workloads on Azure in a way that is fully managed, but gives you full control and customization as if you were running in a VM? I'm going to find out how today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Parik, who's going to teach me all about Azure Database for MySQL Flexible Server. How are you, sir?
I'm doing good, sir. Thank you for having me here.
Absolutely. So, you know, I love MySQL and it scales at a level that I never realized. I thought I started using it for hobby things, but it's a wonderful production database and there's wonderful things happening right now on Azure. There's an evolution of the MySQL offering, isn't there?
You're spot on, sir. And MySQL is like one of the most popular open source database out there. And it has a wide variety of use cases from building an internet scale web and mobile application to e-commerce, gaming, and our LAMPStack application, which we are aware of.
Very cool. So if I was going to get started with this right now, maybe I'm already using the single server, but there's maybe I should get off single server. I understand that some things have changed and that might not be right for me now.
Yes. And let me talk more about our journey of MySQL on Azure. So prior to 2018, the only option for our customers who are migrating or moving their MySQL workloads to Azure was installing MySQL on Azure VMs. And in 2018, Microsoft opened its heart to MySQL with its fully managed open source database service called Azure Database for MySQL. After that, it has been a roller coaster ride, constantly learning from our customers, capturing their feedback, and constantly improving our service. And we are now at a juncture where we have launched a V2 version of the service called called Flexible Server. We have announced the retirement of our V1 version of the service called Single Server. And we are ready to upgrade our customers to a more scalable, performant, cost-efficient, and resilient architecture of Flexible Server, which, by the way, also provides the right control and flexibility to our customers. So Scott, with your permission, I would love to kind of demonstrate some of these capabilities in Flexible Server to you and our viewers.
Let's do it. I love demos.
Perfect. Let's get started. So here in Single Server, if you are starting a new project, you would choose a basic SKU when you're starting a new project. And if you are kind of migrating or building a tier one application like an e-commerce workload, you would choose either general purpose or memory optimized. Memory optimized gives you more memory per vCore, but is limited by the CPU core count, which is 32. General purpose goes more vCore, but then you're limited by memory. And it's kind of feels like a compromise. Contrast to that, in Flexible Server, you start your journey with Burstable if you're building a new project, which is very affordable, a low-cost SKU. But if you're migrating or moving your tier one application, the internet scale application, you would choose business critical SKU. Business critical SKU can scale up to 96 vCore, up to 672 GB of memory, and further it gives you 48,000 IOPS. Further to that, we have also released auto scaling of IOPS feature. By the way, this feature is, we announced it in preview in October, is wildly popular, where you don't have to worry about IOPS. And we have seen this in our support tickets as well. Customers, like 30% of our performance tickets are because customers are struggling that what is the right IOPS they need to provision for their database workload, because it's difficult for them to predict at the provisioning time. So with auto scaling of IOPS, they don't have to worry about that. And the server scales the IO online based on the demand, and they pay as they go. And this further optimizes the cost for them as well.
You know, what I like about this is, just like we said at the beginning, MySQL is great for hobbyists and it's great for big production business critical workflows. And I'm hearing that Flexible Server is good for me as someone doing a small project on the side. I could use a basic, but someone else could go and do something business critical, and my SQL Flexible Server is going to scale in pricing, performance, and memory for me.
That's accurate, sir. That you've articulated it so well. Next, with Flexible Server is zone redundant and supports zone redundant HA. So when you can turn on high availability mode, which will provision a hot standby, and you can for the Azure regions which supports multiple availability zones, you can choose zone redundant hot standby. And that provisions a hot standby across the zone. And that gives you 4 nines of high availability SLA from the servers. So once you choose the SKU which you're looking for, next, with zone redundant HA turned on, you can also select the availability zone. So this is the control we were talking about, Scott. So you can choose the availability zone where you want to place your primary server. And this is needed to reduce the client server or the application database latency. If your application is on zone one, you want to make sure your database, primary database, is also running on zone one. And once you choose that, further, you can also choose where your standby server would be located. So you can choose whether you want it on zone two or zone three as well. And once you're ready to create the server, you will hit create and move on. Next, I wanted to also share with you, now once you have a server provision and high availability turned on, what would be your failover experience look like? So I have a single server provision and I have a flexible server provision. Let me start a script here. So I'm running a workload, a simple workload. It's a simple query, and here we're going to observe the failover time it takes if the server goes down, either due to planned or an unplanned reason. In this case, we're going to simulate a failover event. If I so on the left side, I have a client application connecting to single server. To my right, I have the client application connecting to flexible server. Let's simulate a failover. So I'm doing a restart while the server is running on single server. On flexible server, I am doing something called as a forced failover. And let's come back to our application and see how what is the failover time it takes. So on the flexible server, the failover process has been triggered.
It was quite fast.
And the failover time ranges from somewhere around 10 to 30 or 40 seconds. And it's actually a function of the workload which you're running.
Okay.
As you know, a cloud service has multiple moving parts as well. So there is a variance added here. So flexible server has been completed.
And now on the client side, I would just have retry logic, right? And I'd be watching for these. And in the case of the right-hand side, I was only down for some number of seconds, it looks like. And then that retry logic would pick up.
That's right. That's our spot on. So on flexible server, somebody took around 30 seconds, whereas on single server, this took around 42 seconds. Now, this is just a single client application workload. So you saw a difference when you have just a single query. At a high concurrency, your failover time might be much higher. And you can see flexible server already has 20 to 35% of improvement in the failover time. And that translates into the uptime and availability of your server.
Well, for a major failure of an entire database to have it come back in tens of seconds and not tens of minutes, that's just good business. So that's pretty cool.
Yep, exactly. Next, I want to demonstrate some of the control we were talking about as well. So in flexible server, so unplanned failover, again, rare event, but it happens. But planned failover, we have to pass the server pretty much every month to maintain the compliance requirements we have, make sure the bug fixes are in. With flexible server, you can configure the day of the week and 1 hour time window for the server and what is the optimal maintenance time. And once we are ready to patch, we'll send a 5-day advance notification. So you have full control in deciding the time when you want your server to be patched. In single server, contrast to that, our maintenance windows are 16 hours long, and you cannot configure this setting per server. We have to patch pretty much the entire Azure region. And that doesn't translate into the control and flexibility our customers are looking for. So that's what Flexible Server provides you.
I like that it's not just flexible in price and size, it's flexible in maintenance, it's flexible in all of the features.
Yeah.
And I want to show one more control and flexibility. Again, this is, we've got a lot of customer requests. When the backups are performed, you can see the backups which are being performed on the server. If you want to choose to restore, you can restore a particular backup. And further, you can take on-demand backup. So by default, the system, as a part of a fully managed service, the system takes backup and you can do a point-in-time restore. But generally, for planned events, you're doing application upgrades, schema upgrades, you want to take certain backups. So you can click on here, backup, and you would see the backup timing reflected here. And if you choose to recover, you can always do that as well. So that's another flexibility feature we have. And now I want to share with you that how, like, if you are a single server customer and using single server, how you can migrate to flexible server. So you can use a service called Azure Data Migration Service. Within that, you can create a project where you can define the source, which can be a single server, target, which can be a flexible server. And within that, you can do multiple rounds of migration attempts, just because first you will try, you'll make sure things work for you, and then you'll do a final. So you can do multiple activities or multiple runs. Here I've already completed one migration. You have the ability to do offline migration, which is perfect for small databases less than 100 GB size, where you can afford 5 minutes of downtime and the entire database gets migrated. Or if your database is more than 100 GB and offline migrations you can't afford because you can't afford long downtime, then online migration is your preferred option here. So I have an online migration running here. The initial seeding has been completed. And what I can see is when I'm ready to failover, I would generally monitor the seconds behind source, which tells me that, and by the way, this seconds behind source is running since we have this workload still running. So let me stop the workload now. Yes, so I've stopped the workload. So I want to make sure my data is replicated and refreshed.
Okay, so you're 5 seconds behind in your migration, but they're mirrored effectively right now, right?
Yeah, exactly. And once you would see that the seconds behind master is zero and you're ready to do a cutover, what I would do is I will start cutover here, make sure all my transactions are stopped, which I have done that here, and make sure all the pending transactions are completed, which means this has to be zero. And once I'm ready, I can click confirm and apply, and the database would fail over and make sure you are now ready to migrate, and the database will be migrated to flexible server. So
let me ask you this though, if you don't mind, if I have my existing single already and I want to move to flexible, but maybe I'm worried about missing a feature or there's something that I enjoy and work with in single, what do I do?
Yes, thanks for asking that question. So yes, we are closing that gap. There are a couple of features, private link and cross-region read replica, but we are closing that gap soon in next 2 to 3 months. Flexible server will be at full parity with single server. So you would have no missing features when you migrate to flexible server.
All right. So I'm going. Let's go. I'm going to migrate. I'm going to make it happen.
Awesome. So perfect. I think the viewers can learn more. I think we have a single-stop shop for the viewers. If they want to learn more about MySQL offerings on Azure, aka.ms/MySQL or MySQL-resources. That takes you to the link, and it has everything which we believe you may want to know or learn more.
Very cool. This is great. Thanks so much for spending time with me today.
Thanks, Scott. Thanks for having me.
I am learning all about the evolution of the MySQL offering on Azure today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.